الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ولي الصالحين وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله الداعي إلى صراط المستقيم صلى الله وسلم وبارك عليه وعلى آله وصحبه ومن سار على نهجه واقتفى أثره إلى يوم الدين. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته.
I apologize for the delay. May Allah Jalla wa Ala reward you for your patience, as this is the month of patience. And Allah Jalla wa Ala, He says in the Quran, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu kutiba alaykum as-siyam. Kutiba alaykum as-siyam kama kutiba ala alladhina min qablikum la'allakum tattaqoon. أياما معدودات من كان منكم مريضا أو على سفر فعدة من أيام أخر وعلى الذين يطيقونه فدية طعام مسكين ومن تطوع خيرا فهو خير له وأن تصوموا خير لكم إن كنتم تعلمون شهر رمضان الذي أنزل فيه القرآن هدى للناس وبينات من الهدى والفرقان فمن شهد منكم الشهر فليصم ومن كان مريضا أو على سفر فعدة من أيام أخر يريد الله بكم اليسر ولا يريد بكم العسر ولتكملوا العدة ولتكبروا الله على ما هداكم ولعلكم تشكرون وإذا سألك عبادي عني فإني قريب أجيب دعوة الداع إذا دعان فليستجيبوا لي وليؤمنوا بي لعلهم يرشدون.
After praising Allah Jalla wa Ala and sending salutation from the Messenger عليه الصلاة والسلام, I'm reciting the speech of Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala because it is the best reminder. It is sufficient for me to say and think it's not required. The speech of Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala is enough. Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, He tells us in these ayat that kutiba alaykum as-siyam, fasting has been prescribed upon you, just like it has been prescribed upon those before you, so that you can attain taqwa. Right? Ramadan, it is a month which Allah Jalla wa Ala is disciplining us in it, that you discipline your soul. And that's what Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala says.
Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu ista'inu bis-sabri was-salah. Inna Allaha ma'as-sabirin.
O you who believe, ista'inu, seek assistance, bis-sabri, with patience. Patience, they profess it, they say it is as-siyam, fasting. Was-salah, and prayer. Because these two matters, they prevent you from doing that which is haram. And we have in the hadith of the Messenger alayhi salatu salam, in At-Tabarani, the Messenger alayhi salatu salam, he said, شهر الصبر وثلاثة أيام من كل شهر كصوم الدهر. He said, fasting, the month of patience, okay, and 3 days from every month, it is like fasting the whole year. The Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam called Ramadan the month of patience. Why? The ulama, they say that fasting,
it is from the greatest acts of worship because in it, it is all three types of patience. الصبر على طاعة الله والصبر عن معصية الله والصبر على أقدار الله المؤلمة. Patience upon the obedience of Allah. Right? Allah Azza wa Jalla commanded you to fast, right? Allah Jalla wa Ala commanded you to leave your food and drink. Okay? This is you obeying Allah, you're fasting. Patience requires for you to do that. And sabr an ma'siyatillah. Patience to abstain from the disobedience of Allah. Because the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, he says, مَنْ لَمْ يَدَعْ قَوْلَ الزُّورِ وَالْعَمَلَ بِهِ وَالْجَهَلِ فَلَيْسَ لِلَّهِ حَاجَةٌ فِي أَنْ يَدَعَ طَعَامَهُ وَشَرَبَهُ. Whoever does not leave idle speech, false testimony, lying, all that which is haram, and acting upon it, and ignorance, then Allah Azza wa Jalla is not in need of him leaving his food and drink. Rather, he says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, رُبَّ صَائِمٍ لَيْسَ لَهُ مِنْ صُيَامِهِ إِلَّا الْجُوعَ وَالْعَطَشِ. Perhaps an individual who is fasting, he will not get from his fast except hunger and thirst, no reward. So, here you have the second type of patience, which is leaving everything that Allah Azza wa Jalla has prohibited. It requires patience. And the third type of patience is الصَّبْرُ عَلَىٰ قِدَارِ اللَّهِ الْمُؤْلِمَةِ. Patience upon that painful decree of Allah. طيب, Allah Azza wa Jalla commanded you to fast. You are fasting, you're not eating, you're not drinking, you're abstaining from your desires. Your body becomes tired, you feel pain, hunger, thirst. This is you being patient with the decree of Allah Jalla wa Ala. So all three types of patience are found in fasting. And that's why it's from the greatest acts of worship. And that's why the Messenger alayhi salatu wa narrates to us in the hadith Qudsi that Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, he says, كل عمل ابن آدم له إلا الصوم فإنه لي وأنا أجزي به. Every deed of the son of Adam, it's for him, i.e. he knows the reward. Allah Azza wa Jalla has told us the reward for the deeds of the dream. And in the riwayah of Muslim, rahimahullah Azza wa Jalla, he mentions the hadith of Messenger alayhi salam that it's 700 folds. Okay? Except fasting. فَإِنَّهُ لِي فَرَوْلِي it's for me. وَأَنَا أَجْزِي بِهِ. And Allah Azza wa Jalla says, and I reward for it. And when Allah Jalla wa Ala says that he rewards for fasting specifically, and he has specified the reward, it shows you how great the reward is. Because the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, he says, لِلصَّائِمِ فَرْحَتَانِ فَرْحَةٌ عِنْدَ فِطْرِهِ وَعِنْدَ لِقَاءِ رَبِّهِ. The fasting individual, he has two times he rejoices. He rejoices when he breaks his fast after a long day of fasting, hungry, thirsty. When he's breaking his fast, he's rejoicing. Is he only rejoicing because he can eat food? No. What do you say when you break your fast? Huh? Is there a specific dua that you say when you break your fast? Huh? Is there? What is it? Huh? Okay, for you. Is there anything else that you say? ذهب الضمع وابتلت العروق وثبت الأجر إن شاء الله. نعم. All the أدعية, the du'as that are reported to say when you break your fast, and the most common one is اللهم لك صمت. This is the most common one that people they say, right? This du'a, it's not authentic. Actually, it's actually quite weak, its narration. But the du'a which is slightly stronger, which is not authentic but it's hasan, it's sound, it is ذهب الظمأ وابتلت العروق وثبت الأجر إن شاء الله. What does it mean? The hunger. ذهب الظمأ is not hunger. The thirst is gone. وابتلت العروق, what does that mean? The veins have been filled. وثبت الأجر إن شاء الله. And the reward is ثابت inshaAllah, with the permission of Allah. Na'am, when do you say this? Do you say this before you eat? Do you say it after you finish? Do you say what while you're eating? When do you say it?
Just after you eat.
Just before you eat?
Just after
you eat. Just after you finish eating. Okay. Anything else?
Yeah.
Before
you eat.
I thought it was before you break fast.
Before you break fast. Okay. The ulama have differed. Huh? After?
Because if the du'a says that the veins are filled.
Ahsant. It is not after we eat, but it is after you take the first sip of water and eat the first date. You say it. After you've eaten the dates and you've drank some water, then you say the dua. Not before, because the dua is the dhahab al-dhamma, thirst is gone, right? That means you drank. وَبْتَلَّتْ الْعَرُوقِ in the veins of your throat, وَثَبَتْ الْأَجْرُ inshaAllah. And the reward has become thabit, i.e. that you have been rewarded for that day of fasting. And this is the point that I'm getting at. That the Messenger alayhi salatu salam, he taught us that when we break our fast, what it's about, it is that we are hoping that Allah Azza wa Jalla has accepted our fast and He's rewarded us for it. And that's what we rejoice over. Not only eating and drinking. Okay? And the second one, it is عند لقاء ربه. When he meets Allah Jalla wa Ala, the fasting individual, he rejoices. Why? Because he realizes how great the reward of fasting is. When he's wanted Allah Azza wa Jalla, he will wish that he fasted more. Because the reward. Because the Messenger Ali says in the hadith that one day that you fast for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jal, it will distance you from the hellfire 70 years. I'll tell you, if you're fasting at home, the reward is something you can't comprehend. So this madrasa of Ramadan, Allah Azza wa Jal has granted us this opportunity. And the Messenger alayhi salatu salam, before this month would come, he would excite the Sahaba. He would give them glad tidings. And this is the sunnah. That before Ramadan comes, that we are giving each other glad tidings and exciting one another about Ramadan. We're excited. He would say, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, a month is coming to you. The month of forgiveness. The month that Allah Jalla wa Ala opens the gates of Jannah. And the gates of the hellfire are shut and not a single gate is open. And the maradatu shayateen, the devils, they are shackled. Okay? And then a caller calls out and says, Ya baghi al khayri aqbil, O the one who sees good, come forth. Wa ya baghi al sharri aqsir, and the one who seeks evil, fall back. And he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that every single day of Ramadan, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala beautifies the Jannah for his servants, his righteous servants. And then he says, Jalla wa ala, to the Jannah, that a time will come that is very close that my righteous servants will enter you and they're going to leave the hardship of the dunya. And he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells us, لَخَلُوفُ فَمِ الصَّائِمِ أَطِيبُ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ مِنْ رِحِ الْمِسْكِ. That's the odor that comes out from the mouth of a fasting person, it is more beloved to Allah Azza wa Jalla than that fragrance of musk. And that's why the ulama, they say, here's a point, a side point. The ulama, they say that when you're fasting, the sunnah is after dhuhr to not brush your teeth. Okay, to not brush your teeth. You see work, yes, but to use Colgate, all this stuff, is against the sunnah. Okay? Because Allah Azza wa Jalla displeases him. Okay? But you see work. No one see work without any toothpaste. Tayyib? This is the sunnah. Because Allah Azza wa Jalla, the khaloof that comes out from your mouth, it is more beloved to Allah Azza wa Jalla than musk. And the Messenger alayhi salatu salam, he tells us that in this month there is a night that is better than 1,000 months. It is better, not the same as 83 years of the lifespan, it's better than that. And he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, Man hurimaha faqad hurim. Man hurima khayraha faqad hurim. The one who is prevented from his goodness, the khayr of Laylatul Qadr, then he's been prevented from all of khayr. And Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha wa arda'a, she asked the Messenger alayhi salatu salam, Ya Rasulullah, إذا كانت ليلة القدر فماذا أقول? If it's ليلة القدر, what should I say, Ya Rasulullah? He told her to say, Allahumma innaka afuun tuhibbu al-afwa fa'afu anni. Oh Allah, you are al-afu, the pardoner. Tuhibbu al-afu, you love to pardon. فَعْفُ عَنِّي So pardon me. The only dua that the Messenger alayhi salatu salam told her to ask Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, it is for pardoning, forgiveness and pardoning, indicating how important it is. But in order for you to receive the forgiveness of Allah Azza wa Jalla, you must pardon others. In order for you to receive the pardoning of Allah, you must forgive others. Because Allah Azza wa Jalla tells us in Surah An-Nur, in the qissa of Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, Abu Bakr, after hadith al-ifk, Aisha, his daughter, she was slandered. amongst the people who took part in spreading this slander was a man known as Misbah. And Misbah was a relative of Abu Bakr, and he was very poor. Abu Bakr used to give him an allowance every month. Okay? So, after Allah Azza wa Jal revealed the verses that proving the innocence of Aisha radiallahu anha, Abu Bakr found out that Misbah was amongst those who spread this. So, he cut off the allowance he was given to Misbah. He stopped. Because of him harming his family, he was doing good for him, and this man is harming his family. Right? So Allah Azza wa Jal, he says in Surah An-Nur, that do not prevent وَلَا يَأْتَلِي أُولِي الْفَضْلِ مِنْكُمْ, those who have wealth amongst you. Do not stop from giving that wealth, okay, to the poor and those who are in need, etc. And then Allah says, وَلْيَعْفُوا وَلْيَصْفَحُوا, and pardon and forgive. أَلَا تُحِبُّونَ أَن يَغْفِرَ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ, do you not want Allah Azza wa Jalla to forgive you? So when you pardon others, Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala will forgive you. And this is requires sabr, patience. In order to do this, it requires patience. Then the question that comes is, what is patience? What's the reality of patience? Patience linguistically means al-habs, restraining. That's what it means linguistically in Arabic, al-sabr. And technically in the Sharia it means habsun nafs, restraining the nafs fima takrah limayli rida Allah, restraining the nafs within what it dislikes to attain the pleasure of Allah. That is sabr. You are restraining, holding back your nafs, okay, from its desires that are in contradiction to what Allah Azza wa Jalla loves, and you're doing that in order to please Allah. That is patience. So all the ibadat, ta'at that you're doing, it is built upon patience. Without patience, you won't be able to do it. You require patience. And that's why the Messenger alayhi salatu salam, he praised a man. There was a tribe called Bani Abdul Qais, and they lived in the east side of Arabia. And a man who was a leader, he was known as Al-Ashaj ibn Abd al-Qais. He was a leader, their chief. Al-Ashaj, his son-in-law, had gone to Medina for business. And when he went to Medina, he was exposed to Islam. He heard about Islam, so he was convinced and he embraced Islam. So he came back to his city, and this man is praying. He had memorized some of the Quran, etc. So his wife, who's the daughter of Al-Ashaj, she said, my husband has come back a different man. He told her father. He's praying. He faces the jiha, she means the qibla, every day. And he bows his head and he puts it on the ground a few times a day. So Al-Ashaj, the father-in-law, he comes to his son-in-law and he discusses with him and he wants to hear what's happened and what's changed, etc. So they have a discussion and his son-in-law had a letter from the Messenger Ali, so he gave it to Al-Ashaj. Al-Ashaj, he read it. And Al-Ashaj, after he read it, he was convinced to embrace Islam. He embraced Islam and he rushed his people and he gave them da'wah and they all embraced Islam. So now they all go to Medina to go, you know, declare their Islam for the Messenger Ali. When they reach Medina, they've been traveling for ages, all the way from east to the west of Saudi Arabia. Okay? So they have got there, and the people who are his people, they rush, as soon as they get to Medina, they rush to go see the Messenger Ali. They can't wait to see the Messenger Ali, and they're yearning to see him. As for Ashaj, he doesn't do that. He ties his camel, he goes away, he has a shower, he changes his clothes, and after he fragrances himself, he makes himself look the best, and then he goes to the Messenger Ali, and he enters upon the Prophet, and the Prophet Ali was already had received wahi that these people are coming. So he knew they were coming and he knew who the leader was. So as soon as he walks up, the Messenger alayhi salatu salam tells him to come sit next to him. Okay? And then he says to him, Ya Ashaj, inna fika khislatayn yuhibbuhumullah. Verily in you are two characteristics that Allah Jalla wa Ala, he loves.
الحلم والأنا. Forbearance and not being hasty. These are two characteristics that Allah تبارك وتعالى loves. And then Ashad, he asked, يا رسول الله أتخلق بها أم جبلت عليها. He said, have I managed to attain these characteristics through nurture, or was I born with them? So the Messenger عليه الصلاة والسلام said, بل جبرك الله بهما. Allah عز وجل, he created you with these two characteristics. And then he says, Alhamdulillah الذي جبلني بهذه الخصلتين. He said, Alhamdulillah, the one who created me with these two characteristics. And the point here is that the Messenger عليه الصلاة والسلام praised him for al-hilm, forbearance. Forbearance is a type of patience. Patience is broad. There are different types of patience that have different names depending on the situation. Al-hilm is from one of them. And al-hilm, the ulama, they say, they define it and they say forbearance, it comes from, it means al-aql, using your mind, in being intellectual and using your intellect in difficult situations and thinking it through. Because Allah Azza wa Jalla, he says, إِنَّ فِي ذَلِكَ لَآيَاتٍ لِأُولِ النُّهَى. Oh, and he says another ayah, أَحْلَام أُولُو الْأَحْلَام. Okay, أَحْلَام means, okay, your intellect. أُولُو الْأَحْلَامِ وَالنُّهَى. And the Messenger عليه الصلاة والسلام used to say to the people, لِيَلِيَنِي إِنْ صَلَى. Okay, أُولُو الْأَحْلَامِ وَالنُّهَى. Those who pray behind me, let them be those of أَحْلَام, i.e. intellect, or who have knowledge, and نُهَى. Okay, so it is a type of patience, but the ulama, they say that this حِلْم, it is you holding yourself back and restraining yourself when something angers you that requires a response. You restraining yourself is called forbearance. Something that angers you, which may harm you, which you naturally would think requires a response, you holding yourself back and restraining yourself, this is حِلْم. We have another type of patience, which is الشجاعة. Okay, when you're fighting something, okay, and you're struggling against it, it is called courage and bravery. This is a type of patience. Another type of patience, it is patience when the individual, he is afflicted with a musibah. Okay, and from the greatest musibah, it is when it's in your irb, in your honor. So a person protecting his honor and his and being chaste, it is a type of patience, but in Arabic they call it iffah, being chaste. It's a type of patience, right? And many other types, depending on the situation. So sabr is very broad. And Allah Azza wa Jal, he constantly mentions sabr in the Quran more than 70 times. And every time Allah Azza wa Jal, he mentions sabr, he mentions a result of sabr. For example, Allah Azza wa Jal says about the ulama of Bani Israel. He says in Surah Sajda, the ayah, the beginning of the ayah, Ya Allah. I can remember the end of the ayah and I can't remember the beginning of it, subhanAllah. But that means I have to start the whole page. Should we do that?
Yeah.
Should we read the whole page and get there? خلاص, we'll get there. وَلَنُذِيقَنَّهُمْ مِنَ الْعَذَابِ الْأَدْنَى دُونَ الْعَذَابِ الْأَكْبَرِ لَعَلَّهُمْ يَرْجِعُونَ وَمَنْ أَظْلَمُ مِمَّنْ ذُكِّرَ بِآيَاتِ رَبِّهِ ثُمَّ أَعْرَضَ عَنْهَا إِنَّا مِنَ الْمُجْرِمِينَ مُنْتَقِمُونَ وَلَقَدْ آتَيْنَا مُوسَى الْكِتَابَ فَلَا تَكُنْ فِي مِرْيَةٍ مِنْ لِقَائِهِ وَجَعَلْنَاهُ هُدًى لِبَنِي إِسْرَائِيلَ وجعلنا منهم أئمة يهدون بأمرنا لما صبروا وكانوا بآياتنا يوقنون. مثل الآية. Okay. وجعلنا منهم أئمة يهدون بأمرنا لما صبروا وكانوا بآياتنا يوقنون. Allah says that we have made from them أئمة, scholars from Bani Israel. Allah says يهدون بأمرنا, they are guided with our command. Okay, لَمَّا صَبَرُوا, when they were patient. And then what happens? Because they were patient, وَكَانُوا بِآيَاتِنَا يُقِنُوا. And they had certainty, okay, with our ayat, with our verses. Okay, so Allah Azza wa Jalla says here that when they had sabr, they attained al-yaqeen, certainty in Islam, in belief.
in the Akhirah, etc. And this is a high level to attain. But you attain it through Sabr. Right? Sabr in the obedience of Allah Azza wa Jal. Sabr in your in avoiding and abstaining from the disobedience of Allah. And Sabr ala aqdarillah. Sabr upon the painful decree of Allah Ta'ala. Allah Jalla wa Ala also says in the Quran another result of Sabr. He Jalla wa Ala, he says that a result of Sabr, it is tawakkul. Okay, that you attain reliance upon Allah Jalla wa Ala. Okay, I forgot the beginning of the ayah again, subhanAllah. Should we restart the page? لا إله إلا الله. طيب. لا أرمى بالآية. فاصبر كما صبر أولو العزم من الرسل ولا تستعجل لهم كأنهم يوم يرون ما يوعدون لم يلبثوا إلا ساعة من نهار بلاغ فهل يهلك إلا القوم الفاسقون. الله says فاصبر. Be patient. كما صبر أولو العزم. Just like أولو العزم, those who had determination and reliance upon Allah Azza wa Jal. من الرسل, who are they? From the messengers. Who are they? أولو العزم. إبراهيم. موسى. عيسى. نوح. محمد عليه الصلاة. Those five. Okay, those are called أولو العزم. ولا تستعجل لهم. And do not be hasty. So Allah Azza wa Jalla is telling us to be patient like them. طيب. Now when you look at their patience, Nuh alayhi salam, we start with him. How long was he calling his people to al-Islam? 950 years. Long time, right? And he says, إِنِّي دَعَوْتُهُمْ جِهَارًا. He says, I called them in public. He says, وَأَسْرَرْتُ لَهُمْ إِسْرَارًا. I did it in secret. He says, I called them day and night. Every single opportunity he utilized it. But did they respond? No. Allah Azza wa Jalla tells us how they responded. Allah says, وَمَا آمَنَ مَعَهُ إِلَّا قَلِيلٌ. Only a few believed of him. Allah Azza wa Jalla destroyed them. In Surah Hud, Allah, in many other surahs in the Quran, in destroying Musa and Nuh alayhi salam, it comes back in different forms. But Allah Azza wa Jalla reiterates this point here. But Allah Azza wa Jalla says, Nuh, he says to his people, وَلَا يَنْفَعُكُمْ نُصْحِي إِنْ أَرَدْتُ أَنْ أَنْصَحَ لَكُمْ إِنْ كَانَ اللَّهُ يُرِيدُ أَنْ يُغْوِيَكُمْ هُوَ رَبُّكُمْ وَإِلَيْهِ تُرْجَعُونَ أَمْ يَقُولُونَ افْتَرَاهُ قُلْ إِنِ افْتَرَيْتُهُ فَعَلَيَّ إِجْرَامِي وَأَنَا بَرِيءٌ مِّمَّا تُجْرِمُونَ وأوحي إلى نوح أنه لن يؤمن من قومك إلا من قد آمن فلا تبتئس بما كانوا يفعلون واصنع الفلك بأعيننا ووحينا ولا تخاطبني في الذين ظلموا إنهم مغرقون ويصنع الفلك وكلما مر عليه ملأ من قومه سخروا منه قال إن تسخروا منا فإنا نسخر منكم كما تسخرون فسوف تعلمون من يأتيه عذاب يخزيه ويحل عليه عذاب مقيم حتى إذا جاء أمرنا وفارت النور قل نحمل فيها من كل زوجين اثنين وأهلك إلا من سبق عليه القول ومن آمن وما آمن معه إلا قليل وقال اركبوا فيها بسم الله مجريها ومرساها إن ربي لغفور رحيم وهي تجري بهم في موج كالجبال ونادى نوح ابنه وكان في معزل يا بني نيرك معنا ولا تكن مع الكافرين. قال سآوي إلى جبل يعصمني من الماء. قال لا عاصم اليوم من أمر الله إلا من رحم. وحال بينهما الموج فكان من المغرقين. وقيل يا نوح اهبط وقيل يا أرض ابلعي ماءك ويا سماء أقلعي وغيض الماء وقضي الأمر واستوت على الجودي وقيل بعدا للقوم الظالمين. الله عز وجل says about Nuh عليه السلام, he says ولا ينفعكم نصحي, my advice is not benefiting you. إن أردت أن أنصح لكم, even if I try to advise you and call you, it's not benefiting you at all. إن كان الله يريد أن يغويكم, if Allah عز وجل has decreed that you go, you're not going to accept. هو ربكم, he's your Lord, وإليه ترجعون, and you return to him. And then they said, iftara, he's lying. And then Nuh alayhi salam said, قل إن افتريته, Allah says to Nuh, say, إن افتريته, فعلي إجرامي وأنا بريء مما تجرمون. If I am lying, then upon me is that crime of lying. And I'm going to hold the responsibility for that. But I'm free from the crimes that you're doing. And then Allah عز وجل says, أوحي إلى نوح, it has been revealed to Nuh, أنه لا يؤمن من قومك إلا من قد آمن. No one's going to believe me, people, except those who believe so far. No one else is going to believe that. فَلَا تَبْتَئِسِ مَا كَانُوا يَفْعَلُونَ. So do not let what they're doing affect you, make you sad and feel grief. وَصْنَعِ الْفُلْكَ بِأَعْيُنِنَا وَحِينَ. And make the ship, the ark. Okay? وَلَا تُخَاطِبِنِي فِي الَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا إِنَّهُمْ مُغْرَقُونَ. And do not speak to me and address me, Allah says, about those who have transgressed. For verily they are going to be drowned, Allah says. ويصنع الفلك. So he's building the ark. وكلما مر عليه ملأ من قومه سخروا منه. Every time people from his people, they would go past him, they would ridicule him, mock him. Then Nuh would say, قال إن نسخر منكم كما تسخروا. We are going to mock you just like you're mocking us. It's going to come a point. Because I think he's building an ark on land, there's no water. What's wrong with you? Are you mad? Right? وكلما مر عليه ملأ من قسخر قال إن تسخروا منا فإنا نسخر منكم كما تسخرون فسوف تعلمون من يأتيه عذاب يخزيه ويحل عليه عذاب مقيم. He said to them, and a punishment will come to you that will disgrace you and it will be up forever. Then Allah says, حتى إذا جاء أمرنا, خلاص, now the water's come. وفارت النور, there's water coming out from the ground and it's draining water everywhere. Allah عز وجل commanded Nuh alayhi salam to carry the ship from each animal too, right? طيب. Now he's on the ship. His son, Nuh is calling upon his son. He says, يَا بُنَيْ اِرْكَمْ مَعَنَا وَلَا تَكُمْ مَعَ كَافِرٌ. Oh my son, come aboard and don't be with the disbelievers. His son said, قَالَ سَآوِ إِلَى جَبْلِ يَعْصِمُنِي مِلْمَا. His son, he says, I'm going to go to the mountains, I'll protect me from water. Nuh is قال لا عاصم اليوم من أمر الله إلا من رحم. He says, nothing's going to protect you from the command of Allah except those he has mercy upon. وحال بينهما الموج فكان من المغرقين. And now a wave came in between them. And then his son drowned. So after he drowned and the people were dead, Nuh now, he still had a confession with Allah. Nuh says, رَبِّ إِنَّ بَنِي مِنْ أَهْلِي وَإِنَّ وَعَدَكَ الْحَقِّ وَأَنْتَ أَحْكَمُ الْحَاكِمِ. Ya Allah, really my son is from my family. And your promise is the truth. And you are the most fairest of those who judge. And the most just. Then Allah Azza wa Jalla says, قَالَ يَا نُوحُ إِنَّهُ لَيْسَ مِنْ أَهْلِي إِنَّهُ عَمَلٌ غَيْرُ صَالِحٍ فلا تسألني ما ليس لك به علم إني أعظك أن تكون من الجاهلين. الله قال يا نوح, أو نوح, he's lost me family. إِنَّهُ عَمَلٌ غَيْرُ صَالِحٌ. Verily, he is عَمَلٌ غَيْرُ صَالِحٌ, an unrighteous deed, Allah says. فَلَا تَسْأَلْنِي مَا لَيْسَ لَكَ بِهِ عِلْمٌ. So do not ask me about that which you don't have knowledge about. And I warn you, Allah says, أَن تَكُونَ مِنَ الْجَاهِلِينَ, to be amongst those who are ignorant. So imagine now, Nuh alayhi salam, this is what happened to him. Imagine the patience he had to have in order to bear all of this. The same with Ibrahim alayhi salam, his father, his family, all of those who are beloved to him, they disbelieved. And he had to, in the end, leave them. وَعَتَزِلُكُمْ وَمَا تَدْعُونَ مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ وَأَدْعُوا رَبِّي عَسَىٰ أَلَّا أَكُونَ بِدُعَاءِ رَبِّي شَقِيًّا. He says, and I'll leave you and abandon you. And what you're calling upon, except Allah. And I call upon Allah that عَسَىٰ أَلَّا أَكُونَ بِدُعَاءِ رَبِّي شَقِيًّا. So perhaps I won't be someone who's any unfortunate with the dua of his Lord. This is Ibrahim. His story is long. The same with Musa alayhi salam. And Isa. What happened with Isa alayhi salam? Now Messenger Muhammad alayhi salam. The patient of that. Right. The Messenger alayhi salam, one of the most difficult days upon him was the battle of Uhud. Okay, the battle of Uhud. And Aisha radiallahu anha, she asked the Messenger alayhi salam, Ya Rasulullah, has there been a day that's been more difficult upon you than the battle of Uhud? Because the Messenger alayhi salam, he was injured and his teeth had been broken. And the helmet of the Messenger alayhi salam was stuck inside his head, both sides. And the most 70 of the Sahaba were killed and were martyred in the battle of Uhud. So she said, Ya Rasulullah, has there been a day more difficult than that for you, Ya Rasulullah? He said, yes, the day of Ta'if. When he went to Ta'if sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he was called into Islam, and they sent their foolish and their children and women to stone the Messenger alayhi salam until blood had filled his shoes. But look at that. Patience of the Messenger alayhi salam, his forbearance and his mercy. And this is one of the results of patience, it is mercy, because Allah Azza wa Jalla says, وَتَوَاصُوا بِالصَّبْرِ وَتَوَاصُوا بِالْمَرْحَمَةِ. They advise each other and aid each other upon patience and al-marhamah, which is, and they aid each other upon mercy. So one of the results of patience is that you have mercy. And the Messenger alayhi salam, when the angel of the mountains came to him, he said, command me and I'll destroy them one time. He said, la, rather I make dua that Allah Azza wa Jalla brings from their backs people who will worship you and will disobey. This is another sabr. Now in Ramadan, what shall we do that will make us successful in our Ramadan? Number one, it is that for individual, he observes his fast and he protects his fast from everything that will harm it. Because the Messenger alayhi salatu salam says, من صام وإذا صام أحدكم فلا يغفث ولا يفسق وإذا سابه أحد أو شاتمه فليقول اللهم صائم إني صائم. If one of you is fasting, then he should not do any obscenity or any evil. And if individual insults him or tries to fight him, then he says, I am fasting. He restrains himself. Right. And the reward of fasting, it is great. But the Messenger alayhi salatu salam has told us some of the reward of fasting. He said, من صام رمضان إيمان واحتسابا غفر له ما تقدم من ذنبه. Whoever fasts Ramadan with iman and ihtisab, seeking the reward of Allah Azza wa Jal, his previous sins will be forgiven. And he, from the second deed that you could do in Ramadan, it is that you stand at night and you offer voluntary prayers. Prayers, prayers, prayers. Because these are the two matters that Allah Azza wa Jal mentioned together in the verse that he mentioned. وَاسْتَعِينُوا بِالصَّبْرِ وَالصَّلَاةِ. And salah, it is one of the greatest ways to protect yourself from doing anything evil. إن الصلاة تنهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر. Verily salah, it protects you from الفحشاء obscenity والمنكر evil. ولذكر الله أكبر والله يعلم ما تصنعون. And the Muhammad صلى الله عز وجل is the greatest. And Allah عز وجل knows what you do. So salah. And especially salah at night. The layl, قيام الليل. And he says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, من قام رمضان إيمان واحتسابا غفر له ما تقدم من ذنبه. Whoever stands Ramadan night prayer with iman and seeking the reward from Allah Jalla wa Ala, his previous sins will be forgiven. Okay. And the Messenger alayhi salatu salam, some people, what they do is that they only pray two rak'ah, three rak'ah, and they leave. Yeah, pray all of it. Because the reward of praying all of it is great. He says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, man qama ma'al imam hatta yansarif, kutibat lahu qiyamu layla. Whoever stands with the imam until he finishes the tarawih prayer, then you get the reward of praying the whole night. Imagine tarawih prayer, maybe you only pray for 1 hour. 1 hour and 20 minutes, maybe maximum. Okay, it's not very long. But that 1 hour of the night that you prayed, you get to an order of praying the whole night, and you go back to sleep and you're resting, etc. You're in salah the whole night. Great reward. So don't leave it. Pray until the witr of the imam, so that you can get the reward of praying the whole night. Also, from the acts of worship, that all of our ibadat should be rolling around and rolling around in Ramadan, it is dua. Dua is very, very important. And we should learn as well the etiquette of dua, because Ramadan is the month of dua. The Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, he tells us that the fasting person, every single one of you now who's, okay, you're all fasting at night, see? Okay? You're all fasting now. I don't assume I know. The Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, he says that the angels, they seek forgiveness for the individual who's fasting until he breaks his fast. Every single moment the angels are saying, Ya Allah, forgive him. 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 The whole day. We're fasting how many hours? 17 and a half hours, right? 17 and a half hours, the angel is saying, Ya Allah, forgive. 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 Imagine. But on top of that, an individual who doesn't want to be forgiven will not be forgiven of Allah. Every single opportunity there, it is an opportunity for you to be forgiven. Rather, the Messenger alayhi salatu tells us that وَلِلَّهِ عُتَقَاءُ مِنَ النَّارِ فِي كُلِّ لَيْلَةِ مِنْ رَمَضَانِ. Allah Azza wa Jalla has slaves that he feeds their necks from the hellfire every single night of Ramadan. And he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam also tells us that on the last day of Ramadan, okay, Allah Azza wa Jalla rewards all of his servants who are striving in Ramadan. The Sahaba, they say, Ya Rasulullah, is it because of Laylatul Qadr? He said, No, إِنَّمَا يُعْطَى الْأَجِيرُ أَجْرَهُ إِذَا قَضَى عَمَلَهُ. He said, rather, the individual who is seeking a reward, he is given his reward when he finishes his job. Right? When you're working, it's the same thing, right? On the last day, Allah Azza wa Jalla give you reward for Ramadan. Forgive you. But also from the dua that you should be doing, it is every single moment, because the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam says that there are three, dua is never rejected. As-sa'im, the individual who's fasting until he breaks his fast. And the oppressed one, and the one who's traveling. Dua, dua, dua. From the etiquette of dua, the Holy Messenger, some of the etiquette of dua, first of all, it is to be sincere to Allah Ta'ala when you're making dua. Al-ikhlas, because it's an act of worship, and nothing will be accepted without sincerity. That's number one. Number two, it is to have a conscious heart. Your heart is present when you are making dua. You're not just saying things that you have memorized and you don't know what you're saying. But rather your heart is present, your mind is present when you're asking Allah Jalla wa'ala. Number three, it is to raise your hands up for Allah Jalla wa'ala. Raise your hands. This will make your dua more accepted. Number four, it is to face the qibla. Where is the qibla here? Anyone know? That way? Behind me. To face the qibla where you're facing. Okay? What number was that?
That was number four.
Number five, it is to praise Allah Jalla wa Ala, to start the dua with praise and to show gratitude to Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala. Number six, it is to follow that up with the salutation for the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam. Okay? Number seven, it is to have certainty that Allah Jalla wa Ala will respond to your dua. Because the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam says, Udu Allah wa antum muqununa bil ijabah. Call upon Allah whilst you're certain that Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala will respond to your dua. And what number was that?
Seven.
Number eight, it is to not be hasty in your dua. To not say, for instance, I made dua, it hasn't been responded to. Khalas, I'm not going to make dua anymore. La. You keep making dua. Okay, that was number eight. Number nine, it is that you end your dua with salutation from the Messenger alayhi salatu. So you start it with the praise of Allah Jalla wa Ala and send salutation for the Messenger alayhi salatu wa, and then you end it with salutation for the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. These are from the etiquette of dua, some of the etiquettes. There's many more, but these are some of them. Also, the places that dua is accepted.
in al-masajid umuman, in the masjid, any masjid that you add to the du'as must be accepted. And khususan al-masjid al-haram and masjid nabawi. These two masjid, no doubt that the du'as accepted even more. Times that du'a are accepted. Okay, the last hour of Friday, when it's raining, like now, since it's raining. In sujood, when you are fasting, when you are traveling, these different times, okay, the du'as are accepted the last night of the night. All these times that du'as are accepted, you utilize these times between the adhan, iqama, etc. These opportunities, you don't waste them, you use them to make du'a. Because your du'a will most likely be accepted when you sujood and so on. These are some of the etiquettes of du'a. Constantly make du'a, du'a, du'a. Don't let the moment go past, except that du'a. That you're making du'a to Allah Azza wa Jalla. Rather, Allah Azza wa Jalla pleases him that you make du'a to him. Like the poet, he said, اللهم يغضب إن تركت سؤاله وبني آدم إن سألته يغضب. Allah Azza wa Jalla, he becomes angry when you don't ask him. And the son of Adam, when you ask him, he becomes angry. Human beings, when you constantly ask them again and again, they get annoyed. But Allah Azza wa Jalla, the more you ask him, the more happy Allah Azza wa Jalla will be. And the less you ask Allah, if you don't ask Allah, Allah will be angry with you. So ask and keep making dua. One of the other things that we can utilize in this month, it is Qur'an. It's a month of Qur'an. And this is one of the reasons why I kept reading long passages, because to read more Qur'an and speak. Even though I think I spoke more. Right? It's a month of Qur'an. Read as much Qur'an as possible. Finish the Qur'an as many times as possible in this month. Or at least finish it once. And that requires that after every salah you read 4 pages. Okay. That will be 20 pages at the end of the day. That's a juz. So you're on track to finish the Quran in this month. Okay. At least do that. But to finish it more is desirable, obviously. The ulama, rahimahumullah, and the salaf, when Ramadan will come, they'll leave everything off to the side. And they'll just focus on Quran. Quran, Quran. Okay. So when you're walking, wherever you are, make sure that you have read your Qur'an. And the way you can do that is, some people, what they do is that they try to say after, sometimes it's difficult after every salah to recite some Qur'an, right? طيب. Set yourself a target. Let's say, today the day is not going to end except that I'm going to read 5 juz. You have to find time. Okay, you set the time. Okay, me personally, the time that I read the most, it is this time that you have taken from me. Okay? After Asr to Iftar. But today we give it to you. طيب. So that means I have a debt to make up. So you have to have a time that you read. Okay? And the most and the blessed time that you can have Quran is at night. When it's dark. Because Allah Azza wa Jalla says, إِنَّ نَاشِئَةَ اللَّيْلِ هِيَ أَشَدُّ وَطْعًا وَأَقْوَى مُقِيلًا. That the Quran that you recite at night, it has more effect. It has more effect on the individual. So reciting at night. Okay, so this is a time that you can recite. And most of the time, the night time, you are free. Right? Except those who have exams and revising. Right? But you are free. So recite Quran. The last thing, it is that the last 10 days when they come to do itikaf. If you can. And the Messenger Ali, salatu salam, he would seclude himself in the masjid for the last 10 days, seeking the reward of Laylatul Qadr. Because it's in the last 10 nights of Ramadan. He was sitting in the masjid, engaging in ibadah, dhikr, etc. in order to attain the fadl of Laylatul Qadr. So if you can do that, do itikaf for whole 10 days. If you can't, even do itikaf one night. Even do itikaf between Maghrib, if you enter the masjid Maghrib time, if you're going to be there till Fajr time, intend the intention of itikaf and you get the reward of it. Okay? This is some of the things that you could do, and the last thing is sadaqah. It's the month of Sadaqah. The Messenger alayhi salatu salam, Sadaqatun fi Ramadan, Afdalu Sadaqah, Sadaqatun fi Ramadan. The best of charity is charity in Ramadan. And the Messenger alayhi salatu salam, he would be even more generous in Ramadan than other times. Okay? And I could go into more detail, but you guys know how virtuous Sadaqah is. So we ask Allah Jalla wa Ala to make us from those who benefit from this month. We ask Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala to make us from those who their fasts are accepted, and their salahs are accepted, and their ibadat are accepted. And we ask Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala to forgive us and to free us from the hellfire. and to make us from those who are free from the hellfire tonight.
Yeah.
And we ask Allah Jalla wa Ala to unite us in Jannah just like He united us here today.
Yeah.
And we ask Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala to make us from the people of the Quran, those who are the special people of Allah. And we ask Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala to make us from His righteous servants, those that attain the reward of Ramadan, and those who are successful in Ramadan, and those who reach many Ramadans to come. We ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to make us from those who are successful and attain Laylatul Qadri, Iman wa Ihtisaba, innahu wali dhalika al-qadir alayh. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Alhamdulillah rabbil alamin.
Jazakallahu khairan for attending. Barakallahu feekum. We ask Allah to accept from all of us, from the Shaykh. I wanted to mention three things, inshallah. One of them is, I know all of us have exams coming up in the next couple of weeks, couple of months, inshallah. If you guys are genuinely struggling to find it difficult, it's always senior sisters, senior brothers, to ask for advice and for help. So don't hesitate in asking for help from any of us, inshallah. And number two, there's iftar, I think. Yeah, it's iftar, inshallah. Where will it be?
In the boardrooms.
In the boardrooms, there'll be iftar in the boardrooms. And when's Tarawih? I haven't been here, I've no idea. 10 o'clock, and that chance downstairs or in the bedroom? In the chapel? So, just to summarize, there'll be iftar in the boardroom, inshallah, and there'll be tarawih.